Police began their surveillance of the mill about a month ago using satellite imagery and aerial photographs. Armed with search warrants, a squad of 30 police led by the Upper Hunter Anti-Theft Squad descended on the mill, their discoveries since bordering on the bizarre. Amongst millions of dollars worth of plant and machinery at the mill, they've identified 10 stolen vehicles. One Brambles lorry was inside a shipping container. A Volvo Prime Mover reported stolen 2 years ago was found buried, the site located by Army metal detectors. Cannabis plants worth $140,000 have also been seized.
We've had a valuable success, I think, in recovering vehicles stolen and otherwise vehicle parts.
Police are investigating the possibility that parts from stolen vehicles might have been used to keep mill machinery running. Police are still not totally certain the extent of what they've uncovered here. Every major piece of machinery on the property is being checked, every part on those machines being matched with stolen records. On remote parts of the 15 square kilometre property, police are working with the EPA to uncover what appears to be extensive dumping of toxic wastes. As drums of liquid are unearthed, samples are being sent to EPA labs for analysis. The operation is expected to continue for at least another 2 days. Jim Sullivan, NBN News.
Lake Kinobalus at Orange was the perfect backdrop for the state championships and series final. After races at Wollongong, Penrith, Lake Macquarie and Salamander Bay, the athletes faced the last gruelling leg. For the under-13s and 15s, it was a 400-metre swim, 10-kilometre cycle and 3K run, almost double that for the seniors. An outstanding effort in the under-17 girls for Blacksmiths triathlete Anna Batterham. She opened up a commanding lead on the bike, a leg that isn't a forte. After missing two of the races in the series, Batterham had no chance of pulling back the leaders, but a lightning change into the run gave her an even bigger advantage. The Year 11 student ran in after 1 hour 10 minutes 44. She's now looking at pursuing a surf life-saving career.
I'd like to try for Devondale next year, but with triathlon, I might try out for the Grand Prix if I'm still, fit.
Another big effort, this time by Shoal Bay athlete Scott Hobson. The championship leader headed the field during the cycle before breaking clear in the 5-kilometre run. He's been accepted into the Elite Development Program at the Institute of Sport. Jonathan Upton, NBN News.
Newcastle Harbour's shipbuilding and repair industry nearly died in 1987 when the state dockyard closed. Since then, much of the disused land at the Throsby Basin area at Carrington has been under the control of different state government departments. But today, the land was handed over to the Newcastle Port Corporation in an attempt to return the industry to its former glory.
There was bits and pieces of land held by different state government agencies. I wanted it held by one corporation which has the lead role in government to attract shipbuilding to this port.
The plan is to turn the 11 hectares into an integrated shipbuilding and repair facility, able to handle all naval and merchant vessels up to 40,000 tonnes. The state government is relying on the recent resurgence of activity in the harbour to kick-start the project.
We've got four jacks firing with a helicopter training ship. We've got ADI with a minesweeper. We've got Transfield with the frigates. I mean, these are real contracts with people being employed in substantial numbers.
The state government could fund part of the project, but the private sector will have to pick up the rest of the bill if the plan is to become a reality. Richard O'Leary, NBN News.
For a decade, the event has provided an ever-increasing number with the chance to let off Yuletide steam. Five venues, the Mary Ellen, the Burwood Inn, Souths, the Prince and the Junction Inn, expanded service into car parks, beer gardens and bottle shops. But the Harm Minimisation Act, dealing with responsible serving of alcohol, has entered the picture.
In the past, I used to serve alcohol out in my back beer garden at a portable can bar. Now, not allowed to do it.
Just like the Burwood Inn, the Prince of Wales had been setting up a temporary can bar to keep people placated and less inclined to bring their own glass-packaged liquor.
This year, we'll have to keep the drive-in as it is meant to trade. Unfortunately, we'll have to close it a lot earlier because we don't want to be seen to be enhancing any type of binge-style drinking.
The licensees had considered applying for special Liquor Administration Board approvals for Friday night, but now feel this would be futile.
We've had advice from the Director of Gaming and Racing that wasn't the case, that with the new legislation that this sort of event couldn't be condoned.
From the local licensing police, though, a note of confidence that the crowd will find a drink at another of the city's watering holes, and that planning already in place and police numbers on the night will keep things in check.
We guarantee that things will pass off in a satisfactory manner. Council is working closely with us, as well as the liquor industry.
It was a heated gathering, out-of-pocket subcontractors and workers meeting with union officials to discuss what to do next.
The council really has washed its hands of the matter. The builder that owes the money has gone, and everybody will be quite happy if the job's completed, even though a lot of people don't get paid.
But for the CFMEU, the choice is clear.
We'll authorise a picket on the job if we have to.
25 subcontractors have been burnt by the collapse of the building company. 4 weeks ago, Beattie and Frost went broke, just 1 month short of completing the project. It's been a savage blow for the subcontractors involved, some of whom are owed up to $150,000.
It really stinks the government should do something as far as money that's being lost.
The handful of subcontractors at the meeting voted to consider their options over the Christmas break.
After another year of high achievement in sport in the north of the state, the final field for the Sportstar Award has been narrowed to just 13. Newcastle's Shelley Andrews is one of seven Olympians, along with fellow Novocastrian Natalie Ward. Former Narrabri boy and now Caves Beach resident Jason Stoltenberg has served and volleyed his way into the elite field. Mid-North Coast surfer Nerida Falconer's win in the Mark Richards Surffest in Newcastle has ensured her place. She's joined by Tamworth Olympian Matthew Smith, who represented Australia in hockey. They're among an elite field which includes athletes from throughout the region, with no obvious favourite for the prestigious award. For the first time in years, a rugby league player is not among the finalists, despite having produced two previous winners in Andrew Johns and Paul Harrigan. The Foundation Encouragement Award has gone to New South Wales Junior Sportswoman of the Year, Rosemary Haywood, the Wyong athlete picking up $1,000. Richard O'Leary, NBN News.
Touch of Force paid $12.70 and $4.20, Nick's Joy $7.90 and Persian Flyer $9.90, the Quinella $191.80 and the Trifecta more than $10,000. Back to race 5 now, it was for 2-year-old Colts and Geldings and an effortless win for Darren Biebman's mount, Dance Beat. And it returned $3.70 and $1.50 for the win. Powers paid $2.50 and Big Deeds $2.80. The Quinella $16.50 and the Trifecta $209.60. Race 7 was over 2,000 metres. More big dividends. The winner paid $29.20 and $6.30, $5.80 and $5.90 for the places, the Quinella $280.30 and the Trifecta more than $12,000.
It was the night before Christmas and lights were twinkling from rooftops across many houses in Newcastle. Magical scenes attracted hundreds of festive revellers keen to spread some Yuletide cheer. Meanwhile, singers descended on Newcastle's John Hunter Hospital to share some musical numbers with patients spending Christmas away from home. But it was the excitement of Santa's visit that enticed children from their beds early this morning. Santa and his reindeers enjoyed a midnight snack before delivering lots of goodies, leaving a smile on young faces. Today's warm weather enticed many to the beach, enjoying the sunny conditions and cool waters. Others shared their Christmas lunch in Newcastle's Civic Park. The Hunter Mission provided more than 400 people with some tasty treats for lunch, offering the homeless and lonely some company at this festive time. Christians congregated in their places of worship to celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. The Sacred Heart Cathedral was filled with churchgoers, sermons and song. The partially repaired Christchurch Cathedral in Newcastle beckoned Anglican worshippers.
The Americans haven't had much of a break over Christmas, their cars only arriving yesterday. The last test was an Australian whitewash, but this year the Americans are promising something different.
We're back at full tilt this time. We've brought Steve Francis and Clint Smith and Doc Holliday and myself and Charlie Schwartz, and we're here to do battle.
The teams coexist off the track, sharing equipment and the pit area. On the track, it's another story, and both teams are predicting fireworks for tonight.
Oh, it's going to be hot and heavy tonight. You can bet on it.
There's always is fireworks with American test matches, especially when they get a bit behind the eight ball after half time. They get a bit anxious, and they're normally the first couple of hoots after half time is pretty fiery.
The battle begins at 7:30.
Recreational accidents are down this year, but the number of people involved in car accidents has risen.
Last year in the Christmas period we only did one or two car accidents. To date, up until today, we've done two serious car accidents which we've transported four patients.
Their work began on Christmas Eve after a head-on collision near Maitland. An 18-year-old driver and female passenger were transported to hospital with multiple injuries. This morning's fatal accident near Hawke's Nest drew the rescue team north, airlifting one passenger with serious head injuries. Two cliff falls have also been recorded, one at Pinny Beach and another at Crady Head. Bodies were airlifted on both occasions.
We are up on overall jobs on what we have done to date last year. And I guess with the rate we're going, I would suggest that we will certainly outdo what we did last year.
The rescue team has joined the police in calling for motorists to take care over the Christmas break.
Police will close roads along the foreshore to traffic as they did last year. Jefferson Park opposite the Beach Hotel will be an alcohol-free zone, the foreshore being a glass-free area. The Queen's Wharf Brewery is working with police in preparation for its annual party.
We have 30 security personnel employed. They assist in the area here, but also, more importantly, they assist in the outside area, in the foreshore park, if police require assistance.
Police will also be armed with new legislation that makes it an offence to be intoxicated on licensed premises. The brewery supports the move and doesn't expect any problems on the night.
In past years we're going to fence the whole area with an 8-foot cyclone barrier. There'll be one point of entry for where we can vet people for their age, requirement or intoxication. If they're intoxicated, they won't be admitted.
His record is outstanding, so is his current form. Hot from his winning efforts at Parramatta on Boxing Night, Steve Kinser again left the field for dead in round 7 of the World Series Sprint Cars. It wasn't a matter of whether he'd win, instead by how much, the Sprint Car champion going on to claim the feature race in record time. Some were lucky just to make it through the night, the early heats producing all of the usual action. Hard luck stories came from everywhere, with several of the cars destroyed or badly damaged. Repair work is already underway, with the Motodrome's next meeting set down for New Year's night, the second super sedan test between Australia and the USA.
Newcastle's number one sports ground was a blanket of people, Pakistan making its intentions clear under dark clouds. Merv Hughes refused to let the weather rain on his parade, so hail out for six. Shahid Ali Afridi made his name with the fastest one-day century on record, but he only made nine when caught short by Michael Slater. When Hughes trapped Wasm in front, the visitors were struggling at 3 for 40, but rain came to their rescue as fans took cover. A two-hour delay left both teams with 32 overs apiece, Zahor and Inzaman trying to make up for lost time. Zahor brought up his 50 in 49 balls, Inzaman just as destructive as the pair added 100. The local connection of Greg Geese and Anthony Stewart brought Inzaman undone. A brilliant catch by Lee ended Zahor's innings at 69. Next ball and Moen was out for one. Geese missed his hat-trick, but struck twice more to leave the Hunter 11 chasing 187 for victory. Needing nearly six and over, Slater's bid for a recall to the national team first slipped and then shattered. Former local Anthony Daly fell for 17. That man Greg Geese taking up the challenge, success he falls off Nazir. Mushtaq Ahmed ended the dream, the locals 3 for 63. Captain Greg Arms and state bowler Shane Lee guided the Hunter past the 100 mark, but the chase for runs cost Arms his wicket on 38. Lee skied a catch to leave the invitation 11 in trouble. When state captain Greg Matthews was stumped next ball, the game was all but over. The Hunter all out for 161, Pakistan winning by 25 runs. Richard O'Leary, NBN News.
For one young couple, the last day of 1996 was the most important of their lives. Set against the backdrop of Redhead Beach, Dennis and Susan exchanged vows and rings. A kiss setting the seal on the start of a new life together and a new year just around the corner. New Year's Eve celebrations in Newcastle kicked off with a spectacular fireworks display over the city, a pyrotechnic dance of colour and light painted on a canvas of a clear summer evening sky. The good weather drew thousands down to the foreshore to enjoy the open-air entertainment. Some, though, chose a formal welcome to 1997. Restaurants throughout the city were packed with revellers in black tie and evening dress, champagne at the ready to whet the head of the newborn year. In nightclubs, partygoers danced their way towards the year ahead. The biggest single party drew thousands to the Queen's Wharf Brewery. Popsters Ganga Jang pumped out the hits with a New Year's wish. Then it was out with the old year and in with the new. While crowds were generally well behaved, most more interested in an amorous start to the year, police reported a busy night. Patrols in Newcastle made 11 arrests on 22 charges. Most were minor offences, however, there were also several stabbings. Ambulance crews were also kept busy by 150 call-outs. For them, the dawn of a new day and a new year was a welcome sight. The rays of the sun also ushered in the start of a year-long party for Newcastle as the city celebrates its 200th birthday. No party, though, for the small army of council workers left to clean up the morning after the night before. As the last of the revellers made their way home this morning, thoughts of the year ahead were replaced with more immediate concerns, the search for a good hangover cure. Phil Hind, NBN News. Ideal sailing conditions greeted the 47-strong fleet for Heat 5 of the A-class titles. The 12-knot southeasterly made for some tight tussles around the Olympic-sized course. While the A-class is not an Olympic-category catamaran, it attracts a wealth of Olympic talent, the likes of Atlanta silver medalist Andrew Landenberger.
There's such a competitive class of boat, and people moving off a higher class boat such as a Tornado, which is the Olympic class, they enjoy moving back to the A-class just to keep the hand in between Olympic titles.
Among the leaders today was reigning A-class world champion Glenn Ashby. Although it's the Australian titles, boats from the United States and New Zealand are also competing. Today's heat went to Paul McKenzie in the KPMG Cat by a comfortable margin. With just two heats remaining, the Australian title is still up for grabs.
Glenn Ashby, Tim Kirkham and probably Paul McKenzie, they're probably the three at the very top at the moment. But you never know.
The titles conclude on Tanilba Bay on Friday. Phil Hind, NBN News.
Master Raider paid $4.40 and $1.50. Jean Valjean paid $1.70 and Hunter Winemaker $1.20. The Quinella $15.20. The Trifecta $63.30. They were also racing at Royal Randwick today. The feature race, the Carrington Stakes, over 1,000 metres. The winner, Flaming Hot, paid $5.60 and $1.90. Winning Hand, $3.90. Circle the Globe, $4.30. The Quinella, $54.30. The Trifecta, a handy $1,061.20.
Hiring a taxi became a dollar dearer 6 months ago. Since then, revenue has fallen by 10% at Newcastle Taxis, a trend repeated across the region, with operators at Maitland and Gosford also reporting a sharp drop in customers. The increase takes the street fare to $3, which has turned many people away from smaller trips, the taxi industry's bread and butter. Despite the downturn, the big taxi operators support the levy.
Package of reforms includes uniforms, corporate livery for vehicles, air-conditioned vehicles, vehicle tracking systems and other driver safety measures.
Many of the benefits are still to be introduced, which means people are paying for some services not yet available. It's hoped when the improvements to the industry are complete, people will start hiring again. But a problem that refuses to go away is the falling number of people hiring taxis in Newcastle's Central Business District. The West End has become a ghost town of vacant shops, with more than 45 buildings not being used, despite council's attempts to attract investors.
The local shopping areas, people tend to be congregating to those rather than coming into town.
Richard O'Leary, NBN News. There's simply not enough people catching buses in Newcastle and Lake Macquarie, with the service running at a $4 million loss last year. It's hoped that will start to turn around with the new time-based tickets.
There will be three basic cash fare tickets, a 1 hour, a 4 hour and an all-day ticket.
The system aims to make bus travel easier and cheaper, with people to pay by the hour rather than the distance travelled.
Well, there are a lot of advantages. One, it's a very simple ticket. At the moment, you must know what section you're getting on, what section you're getting off, how much that fare is going to be. We're virtually saying it's a $2 flat fare right across Newcastle.
The system will also help to reduce the number of fare evaders. But not everyone will win. People who travel less than 4 kilometres will pay more.
There is one disadvantage in that the people that normally travel or currently travel 1 to 2 sections will have to pay slightly more for their travel, but that is a very small percentage of our total fares.
Pensioners and students will pay no more than they do under the existing system. The 6-month trial starts on Monday. Richard O'Leary, NBN News.
In the past 2 months, there have been 11 cases of the mosquito-borne disease in the Hunter. That's slightly more than for the same time last year.
It's early days to say whether we're going to get the peak through January and May that we had last year. But there's an indication that it might be just beginning.
In 96, there were a total of 80 cases of Ross River virus in the Hunter. Traditionally, the worst month is April. The virus produces symptoms very similar to flu. However, sufferers also experience painful swelling of the joints and sometimes a severe rash.
There's no cure for Ross River fever. The best doctors can do is hope to relieve the symptoms. In some extreme cases, Ross River is much like malaria in that it can reoccur years after the initial infection.
Recent high tides, rain and warm weather have produced perfect conditions for mosquitoes to breed. Local councils are trying to combat the problem at the source, but say it's not easy.
In a lot of cases, we can't get into some of these areas. They're very difficult. So we do the best we can. We work from the houses and go outwards. And we try to give relief as best we can.
As obvious as it sounds, the best defence is not to be bitten. Health authorities suggest people check fly screens, cover up and use plenty of insect repellent. Phil Hind, NBN News. For the past 10 years, the old library in Smart Street has been home to the East Lakes Youth Centre. However, it's on borrowed time. The building is to be demolished to make way for commercial development.
The committee and the youth workers have always known that the council was just making use of a building available on a temporary measure.
On a Thursday night, as many as 120 youth used the centre's pool tables and meeting places. An anonymous letter circulated around businesses in the Charlestown area warns the closure of the centre could turn the area's relatively minor juvenile crime problem into a major one.
I think it's probably a slight exaggeration. I mean, there may be a slight increase, but no more than usual.
Lake Macquarie Council agrees. The council is now looking for a new home for the centre, the most likely candidate sharing the community centre in Charlestown Square. Ultimately, though, the council says a permanent home is up to the state government.
We were really disappointed when Lake Macquarie missed out on the youth centre because we do have a higher youth population than the other local government areas that did get the funding.
The council is preparing another application to government to fund a permanent youth centre. Phil Hind, NBN News.